I am of the mindset that Doug Peterson's got to get fired. I'm of the mindset that Doug Pederson, if this report is true,
yeah,
and it's been
we speculated about it yesterday.
We did. And I was very direct and very transparent in what I'm thinking. Like, I don't think that he's the one that's going to remove them from this malaise, because quite frankly, he's the one who really kind of brought them into this
right.
depth of malaise. Right?
That's right.
Certain things you can't control, but certain things he just messed up. You know, Teak, this report has been mildly refuted that there was a revolt and some players wanted to attack him.
Yeah.
If that is remotely true, he cannot coach this team another day.
You know what, BT, you're right, because it means that those guys don't trust him to lead them the right way. Now, I'm not saying to lead them to victory, because, look, he's a Super Bowl winning coach. You can't take that away from him. But since that time, winning that Super Bowl, that is, they have been under 500 by a couple of games. And it hasn't been pretty. I mean, yes, last year they made the postseason, but it was only because the Dallas Cowboys were incompetent coming down the stretch. And so this season, with four wins and 11 losses and the one tie, and especially that last loss, which seemed intentional, to BT's point, there were at least two, maybe even more defensive players who were physically trying to go after Doug Pederson on the sideline. This isn't like in the locker room after everything is said and done and, you know, it's behind closed doors. This was happening on the sideline. I'm sure somebody has video footage.
Man, we'll get it.
Exactly. It'll show up at some point. And then you hear the offensive player saying, we had no idea that this was going to be the plan. Center Jason Kelce basically co-signed what Joe Judge said. Yeah. You play every game once the game is snapped to win it, not to position or get into, you know, better draft position. It's not just one guy who's anonymously saying he has a problem with this. It's a bunch of guys saying they're having problems with this, BT.
Yeah, yeah. And I want to play some from Howie Roseman. And then I want to play some of that Joe Judge sound, too, which, boy, again, if I'm a Giants fan, I'm sitting there saying, that is my coach, boy. That is my coach. I love Joe Judge.
Yeah.
But when you do an end-of-the-year press conference, as GMs do, right, and you'll hear the words disappointing as they frame the season when there's a negative connotation.
Yeah.
You very rarely hear the word embarrassing.
That's right.
And that's one of the words Howie Roseman reached for. Again, certain things you can control, certain things you cannot. But and correct me if I'm wrong here, Tegan. I'm not trying to be unnecessarily harsh toward Doug Pederson, but we've been critical, me a little more than you, but you too. But as a show, I think we've been on point with Doug Pederson. This is not, you know, trying to pile on. This is not, you know, sensationalizing something that where there's no real merit. Like Doug Pederson managed in one season to destroy a relationship with a quarterback who just a couple of years ago almost won the MVP and was granted over $100 million, and at that point rightfully so by the Eagles.
Yep.
And then in one swooping motion on Sunday night on national TV, managed to clip the wings from his slowly learning to fly ascending bird, Jalen Hurts. Competitive game? Oh, this isn't a teachable moment. Sit down. We're not going to use this to propel you to better heights in the future. We're going to actually embarrass the franchise, which is what he did.
That's exactly what he did, BT.
And the league, by extension.
No, you're right. And that's the bigger issue. And we mentioned this yesterday, what Peter King said. He broke an unwritten, you know, code of honor that exists between coaches. Once the game starts, like before the game starts and you're going to sit XYZ player down because they need to rest or they have an injury or whatever it may be, that's one thing. But once you start playing football, you have 60 minutes to finish a football game, and every single effort should be trying to winning. That's why when you see teams who are losing by two touchdowns and say they finally get there, they're about to score, they start getting really call the timeout here, conserve the clock. Let's practice this, because if we score this one, maybe we'll get the onside kick and we have a chance. Like, you always play to the end. Doug Pederson didn't play this game to the end. And, you know, if there was any speculation that guys understood what was going on, Miles Sanders, their running back, had a very interesting response when asked if he knew or anyone else knew that this plan was in place to put Nate Sudfeld in for Jalen Hurts. A lot of people were confused, and nobody liked the decision. Not like we on offense didn't like the decision, or you know, the defensive guys didn't like the decision, or five or six guys, you know, disagree with the decision. Nobody liked the decision. What that tells me is that Doug Pederson has better get down and grovel to get his respect back in that locker room.
But I don't think that that's going to even do it.
It might not, but he's got to if he wants to save his job, BT, because these guys, at this point, you're looking at, every time you look at him, this is what you're going to think about. You know what I mean? It's like, like if we're having a bad day, are you just going to, you're going to throw in the towel, right? You're going to, if we have a bad day, you're just going to lay down. Like that's what it feels like. And it would be hard unless he comes with a real strong, solid mea culpa. And I don't know, tries to make me feel better about the decision that he made. That's going to be hard. And here's the reason why. Mm-hmm. Because draft equity means bupkis to the guys on the team right now. You know why? Because
they're not going to be around to bear
the fruits. They're going to draft somebody that's going to replace you. That doesn't sit well. Like, positioning for draft position for a player is nonsense. And in fact, it angers you because you know it just puts you in a position to be replaced. Yeah. And so he's dug himself a hole, and he keeps talking about it in ways that we're going to all of a sudden just say, oh, yeah, you're right, Doug. You're not right. You weren't right. And I'm surprised he hasn't apologized already.
Yeah, I know.
At some point, he's going to have to, because this is getting out of hand with how it's being received, not just outside the organization, but inside the organization.
Doug Pederson is now entering battle without a weapon. Yeah. And let me explain what I mean by that. I'm sure you get the inference, but, you know, any coach in – listen – there's individual sports that are more violent than football, but there is no sport out there that requires 11 people at the same time to be in unison, both mentally and physically, right?
Yep.
And in accord with everybody, to know what's expected, to follow through on what's expected, to at least try your best, right? So at the moment, and over the course of 16 games in 17 weeks, especially when you don't have a ton of talent, as the Eagles need to reboot in a lot of different areas, you're going to have some real prolonged down points. And when that happens, much like when the Giants were losing a couple of games in a row this year early on, right, before they got hot and they started ripping off those dubs and changed the complexion of how we view them, Joe Judge was able to connect to them in a way with the weapon would be belief, right? Okay, you know, it's a little blind faith in this guy, but, man, he's believable, and what he's saying – I'm going to latch on to it because this seems like a guy that I want to fight for. When that happens to the Eagles, whether it's an individual player in practice, whether he lights up into an individual unit during film session, whatever it might be, they're going to think, and some might be bold enough to say, hey, you expect us to do this when you did that? You're toothless.
Yeah, that's right.
Which is why, in my opinion, you might as well fire him now.
Yeah, because it can always be held against him. It will always be held against him.
Not only by the players, but in that unforgiving, sports-crazy town. He will never get the benefit of the doubt from an effort point of view, from an execution point of view. Even when he's right, I think it's going to be clouded by maybe misjudgment based on we no longer believe in you, Teak.
The only thing that I would disagree with is that the fans, in some ways, might agree with them. Because just like with the Jets fans who are rooting to lose.
Talking about draft slots?
Yeah, exactly. Like, maybe fans would understand. Maybe they would understand.
But I don't think they understood the whole erosion of Carson. Like,
In totality, you're absolutely right.
And it's not like they were standing, put it this way, before the whole yo-yo with Hurts on Sunday night. It's not like Eagle fans, and a couple of my good friends are real Eagle fans.
Yeah, mine too.
I know. They weren't standing in unison like, our guy. Right. Like, unflinchingly.
That's right.
Hey, it's been a rough year. Doug, that's our boy right there. They're like, this guy's not that good.
Yeah.
This guy's, he's kind of messy on game day. Mm-hmm. He's sloppy at the podium.
Yep.
Like, Eagle fans had already jumped off. Sunday night was just the final splash in the water.
It really is.
I don't know.
It's hard to see how this ship gets righted.
But I don't think it does.
I don't
think it does.
I haven't heard anything that they're contemplating. moving on from him and firing him. I would be surprised, honestly. But here's the thing. We said this yesterday. This is not going to be a one-day story. We've led with this twice now in a week, right? Mm-hmm. Playoffs are this weekend, right? We're leading with the Eagles twice in this week. In 2 days, which tells you something about this situation because it flies so egregiously in the face of competition.
Yep.
And you know, I was reading some snarky tweets over last evening, and you know, the Philadelphia 76ers, they put like three or four guys on the bench, and it's like, oh, Giants, be, you know, watch out.
I saw that.
Basketball is different, man.
Yeah, I saw that.
In a basketball game, if you're 25 points down, you concede, man. It's not worth it, right? Guess what? At this point, there's how many are left? There's 65 or 67 games left. Mm-hmm. It's okay. But in an NFL season, you just don't do that. It's never been okay to concede a game in the NFL. And it just feels like, I don't know. I don't know how he recovers from this. And not just perceptually outside, but I mean inside his locker room, how does he recover from this? The one thing we said yesterday, like if we start to hear that there was dissension, this is when it gets ugly.
Yes.
You're starting to hear dissension.
And here's the thing. Even if they, quote unquote, patch it up before the start of next season, that first 2-3, you know, you're 1-2 or you're 2-4 or whatever you are, you lose a game you shouldn't. It's going to reverberate. It's going to go right back.
Right. He's got to be perfect. He doesn't get the benefit of the doubt anymore.
It changes everything.
That's right.
Now, in stark contrast, I want to play this before we break and get into the Brown situation, which is awful. Joe Judge. Now, this is just the audio, obviously, but I can promise you, and Teek, you saw this too.
Yep.
You can see he had to work hard when you're actually seeing the video with the audio to restrain himself to not say that. Like, Joe Judge is wired in a way, you could just tell that when Joe Judge snaps, I think it's pretty loud, and I love it.
I think you're right.
Thanks for watching. Make sure you like and subscribe, and don't forget to hit that bell to be notified when we drop fresh content.